Who's heard of AI? Okay, good. So most of you have heard of this two-letter acronym that has the potential to be as influential as the ABCs. The state of AI in 2025 is pretty crazy. We've got tech company executives encouraging that their software engineers become vibe coders to prompt engineer and talk to AI instead of doing the programming themselves. And then modern AI models have gone chain of thought, the ability to reflect on its answers before it even says anything. And then we have models like GPT-4, which passed the bar exam in all US jurisdictions, and then MedGemini, another model scoring 91% on patient diagnosis accuracy. And then already, McKinsey from a global survey reports that 78% of companies globally are already using AI in at least one business function. Wow, okay, so what do they need us for, right? In a year, AI is gonna learn how to grow arms, grow legs, and then it's gonna learn how to do the dishes, and really, I'll have nothing to do. I'm scared. As a student, I'm worried that the things I'm learning today might not be relevant tomorrow. I'm scared that AI is gonna get us all fired from our jobs. But before we go the glass half full approach, there's something else that AI reveals about work. There's a lot of things that AI can do, but there's also things that it can't. And I think that reveals the menial parts of our jobs. The parts that we can totally handle, we can dig through files, get through busy work, but we can also do a lot more. We can solve challenging problems in unexplored spaces. Maybe AI reveals the most human parts of our work. We've seen things like AI before in the form of the self-checkout. When the self-checkout came along, it wasn't the end of all cashiers. It just made us realize that being a cashier isn't just scanning items. It's also giving good customer service and solving unexpected problems. Technologies like the self-checkout and AI reveal that not all tasks are uniquely human. We're perfectly capable of scanning items, but we're also capable of a lot more than that. Whereas something like a self-checkout, one wrong move and forever it's stuck on, "Please remove the item from the bagging area." Okay, but that is just one example, and obviously cashier, that's not representative of every single job out there. That's true. But even in a very different role, when I was working as a research assistant, trying to contribute towards climate change solutions, keyword trying, what I wound up doing was mostly removing commas from an Excel spreadsheet. Yay! And the crazy part is, I think most of the work I did could have been replicated in a matter of days using AI, whereas it took me more like months. And I'm not saying the work I did was pointless, it was necessary work. But I started that role wanting to make big picture impacts. I wanted to get fulfillment from my work. And I think AI could have been the thing that let me do that. I love AI. Hold on, we're getting ahead of ourselves. It's not that simple. AI is threatening. It's eerily human, and obviously, it's not the same level of a threat as just some self-checkout machine. After all, it seems like more people are falling in love with AI chatbots than self-checkout machines, so. So then why is it so threatening? Why is it scary, and how do we deal with it? Well, to answer that, I'm gonna define a knowledge framework to basically rank how smart AI is. Knowledge work can be broadly defined in four categories, starting at level one, information retrieval. If you've ever seen anything, read anything, heard anything, and then remembered it later, that's information retrieval. I hope you've done that. This is something that AI is really good at. You can ask it for all kinds of information, from dinner recipes to physics formulas. And then after that, next up is level two, pattern matching. This is about noticing patterns. Say you're in a customer service role and you've noticed that your company's getting bombarded with a lot of bad reviews. Yikes. You haven't begun thinking about the why just yet, but you're just noticing that pattern. And again, this is something that AI is really good at because modern AI models are built with architectures like the transformer architecture, which fundamentally are really good for recognizing patterns. After that is level 3, contextual judgment. This is when we begin asking the why behind patterns. You're using a little bit of domain knowledge to answer the why. So in that customer service role, maybe you've heard that your suppliers are getting a lot of faults in their machinery. So you put two and two together, you realize, oh, we're probably getting bad reviews because our supplier's messing up. And this is the part when AI begins to struggle, because AI needs specific domain training, and when it doesn't have that, it can't always answer the why. Now finally, we have level 4, the crown jewel, creative recombination. This is that aha moment when you have a new idea, you have a light bulb moment from your existing knowledge. So in that customer service role, maybe in university, you took a few business and engineering classes, so then you apply that knowledge, you suggest to your boss, hey, I have this multi-step plan that's cost-effective and it's gonna fix our bad reviews at the root cause. You're suggesting a new solution, something that's unique, something that hasn't been done before. That's level 4. And this is a level that AI has not been able to touch. So then, why is AI so scary? Well, it's because it's encroaching on knowledge work levels that previously were untouchable. A self-checkout, all that does is beep, beep. And what's happening there is it's just retrieving information. That's level 1 knowledge work. It's getting the prices of items and that's it. But AI can do that. It can do level 2 knowledge work and it's touching on level 3 knowledge work. So what do we do? How do we make sure that AI is a tool that will help us enjoy the more human parts of our job without outright replacing us? Well, let's think about what AI isn't so good at. If you've used AI before, you know it's a pretty cool tool. It can tell you a lot of useful information, but it's not always reliable. The other day, I was interested in learning a little bit about Edmonton, so I asked GPT, hey, tell me some fun facts about this place. And so it tells me about this LRT train tunnel that goes under the Saskatchewan River. Wow, I love trains, I love tunnels, I'm happy. But unfortunately, I have eyes and I've taken the train before. So I know that actually it goes on a bridge and not under a tunnel. So I tell that to GPT and it says, no, you're wrong. Okay, so I explain, but I have eyes and I've seen the river, you can't see that in a tunnel. And the more I push, the more elaborate its explanations get. It goes to say, the bumps on the track, they make you think you're going up, but really you're going down into a tunnel. Stop. Give me a source then. And as soon as I asked that, it backtracked on everything it said and said, there's no tunnel. Okay, so it's smart enough to pass the bar exam and maybe become a lawyer, but then it decides to lie for fun? Why? Well, the shortcomings of AI come from the way it's fundamentally built. It's easy to anthropomorphize AI because it can sound so human. But it's not a brain. It's a mirror that reflects the collective human knowledge through patterns. It's trained using an input-output black box approach where we feed it an insane amount of text, tune it for every single input until it says what we want in each output. It becomes an amazing imitator of the text that it's trained on. But it doesn't learn the same way that humans do. You and I, we follow a layered knowledge acquisition method where we start from our basics and we move up. As a baby, you do your level 1 knowledge work, you learn your basic information. Smiley faces are good, frowny faces are bad. A few years later, you learn about basic math. Odd number plus odd number is even number. There's your patterns, your level 2. And then you begin asking why. You move on to level 3. Once you figure out the why, maybe you're really talented as a child and you propose a new theory. Guys, I know how to find out if any sum is even or odd. Wow. The point is, AI can skip these layers. It can directly get really good at adding odd numbers without even knowing what numbers really are. And even when you ask modern AI chatbots for explanations, the explanations you get are collages of what people have written online. And that's why AI is not a brain. It's trained on the internet. a countless store of many human ideas all in one place. Centuries of human innovation and culture have been digitized and fed into AI as training data, so that when AI speaks, we're hearing reflections of our collective knowledge, not original thoughts from AI. So then how do we deal with it? How do we know that it's not just going to be here to replace us? Well, we use our human intelligence, HI, if you will, to reason about the blind spots that AI has because of its shaky foundation of knowledge. We do our work there, and then we leverage the strengths of AI to take care of the menial parts of our job. For instance, one of AI's big blind spots is it doesn't understand the weight of importance. You and I know through countless life lessons that making a decision that affects lives carries far more weight than deciding what's for dinner. But because AI doesn't know this, it leads to cases like last year's Google AI search overview, when it suggested to users, if you're sick of the cheese on your pizza sliding off, just put some glue on there. We know that's a big no-no, because before we get to the cheese pizza making part, we know that step one is you don't eat glue, and that's important. And because AI doesn't know this importance, it makes these silly mistakes. And that's really problematic in today's workforce, because even the least complex human jobs expect a decent level of human reliability. And that's why you can leverage AI as a tool where you use it to give you reports on information. You treat it like the pseudo-employee, but you need to make the call. You hold the final responsibility. Another one of AI's blind spots is its inability to do level 4 knowledge work. It doesn't create truly new ideas. If you've played around with modern AI image generators, maybe you've asked, hey, show me an image full of wine, a glass full of wine, like really full. Most of them will try, and they'll struggle, but they'll just kind of show you the normal amount of wine in a glass. And that's because there's not enough lunatics on the internet posting images of wine glasses filled to the brim. But wait, it can show me images of glasses of juice filled up to the top, and that's not really that different from wine, like grape juice. But that's the key point. It can't do this level 4 knowledge work. It can't draw from its existing knowledge and create a new idea. And again, that's really problematic for AI because fundamentally, that's what jobs are asking for. They're looking for someone with experience, a knowledge base, and asking on them to draw from that knowledge to create a unique solution for that job's unique problems. So here's what I suggest. Imagine what your life would look like if you had AI as your pseudo-employee, working on the menial parts of your job, leaving you free to focus on the big picture. Maybe it's not quite the end of humans in the workplace, but it is the beginning of a new age of automation. Yesterday's fears of the self-checkout have been replaced by today's fears of AI. And along with that comes a push for people to operate at higher than ever levels of reasoning. And that's scary. But fear can be blinding, so I'm asking you to open your eyes and imagine the possibilities. What would you create if you could focus on the most human parts of your work? Thank you.